Hello, welcome to Grill the Gaffer. I'm here with Karl Robinson, the Charlton Athletic Manager, and he will be answering your tweets. Let's have a look at the first one, Karl. This is from George Wright. How do you deal with a big ego in the dressing room?
Depends whether he was affected the pitch or not. I think sometimes you get players who have a big ego that sometimes think they're better than what they actually are and have no impact whatsoever on a Saturday afternoon. And if the ego is supported by the talent, I have to work hard.
Indulge it.
I have to let them off with things. But no, I think that the better they are, the more you'll want to work with them and try and integrate him into the group and see if we can dampen his ego. But sometimes I think players need it. I think without an ego, without a bit of self-confidence, I don't think you're going to be successful in the industry anyway. So, dare I say, maybe 95% of them have an ego anyway. So, some of my
squad. We're not offended by that, it's fine.
You might have had it. Do you have an ego?
I've got rid of it a long time ago, it's fine.
Keep it.
And this one's from Thomas Drinkwater. What formation should I play when playing against a long ball team? Quite a big concept, a long ball team, isn't it?
I was speaking to Keith before we came in here, and I've got this big bugbear on using midfield play. I think there's nothing worse than a centre-back getting a midfield player to stand on somebody's toes. I think we've gone away from the old... The centre-back should be able to go and compete with the first phase. I don't think you should drop a midfield player who's worse than you in the air to compete with somebody who's better than him in the air. So, for me, it's about two phases. It's one, having somebody who can early cope with the first phase. And then secondly, having a group of players who are willing to do it. The first phase never scores the goal. It's the second phase that scores it. So it's about you reducing the ratios of the opposition within the second ball. So the more you can surround that phase one, the probability and the percentage of you winning the second phase is a lot higher than the opposition. So we've been working on one or two things. There's certain games that we're playing in League One that you have to cope with the demands of that very, very quickly. So for me, it's getting centre-backs to go and compete. Don't cheat. Don't get a midfield player to do your job as a centre-back. And then how you can flood the zones to make sure that you can pick up second phases. But understand it's a second phase.
Not necessarily just the first.
So you're going. I always say three mistakes generally lead to a goal. So it could be the loss of the header, not tracking the runner, and somebody not covering. So you get an opportunity against a long ball team after you lose the first header to try and cope with their threat.
Michael McGubbin, what's the ideal routine for a pre-match warm-up?
Depends who you ask. I think sometimes you have to go with some players, maybe the older you got in your career, you felt sometimes less is more.
Maybe the tailor it to the individual.
And sometimes what you eat before and everything. But the pre-match warm-up, I think, should consist of how many touches you get the ball, how you can raise your heart rate, obviously, get you to that level where you're almost getting your second breather within your warm-ups when the game starts. You're physically ready, but more importantly as well, you're mentally ready for the challenge, because I think sometimes the mental aspect of the game we forget about so much. And I think it's a more... With us, we'll have a passing drill, we'll have a possession, and then beat the back four, they go some head in the fields, they go and do some finishing, and they'll come into me for a rah-rah before they go out.
Fantastic. Right, final tweet from Kieran Carlin. How do you stop your best player from losing his head and getting sent off? This might dovetail with the first one about ego, mightn't it?
People, I remember when we had people always talk with Dele Alli about him and his aggression. Never lose that. I think sometimes for one red card, you win.
It's vital to make him the player that he is.
And we talk so much, especially in the media, about the sending off, the lack of discipline and everything else that goes with it. But for me, if that makes you who you are, and you're a worse player without that, as a manager, I'm doing you a disservice. You would ask him to be a little bit more careful. I'm not saying players should get sent off. We had a player sent off this week. So I had two sent off in the first two games of the season for challenges that I didn't think were sending off. So sometimes you've got to be careful with that. But I wouldn't overly worry about changing somebody who wants to compete. You take that out of somebody, and sometimes you do have half the player, especially in the midfield area. And to be fair, just tell the referees to get better.
A nice place
Don't tell the PGM.
Well done. Thank you for joining us,
Karl. No problem.
Join us next week for more Grill the Gaffer.